Simon & Schuster Audio presents Under the Influence, a novel by Noelle Crooks, read by Midori Francis.
To everyone who has always believed in me, but more important, to everyone who didn't. Yep, it's that kind of book.
Chapter 1. Girls Gotta Eat. Girl, are you tired of everyone telling you what you can and can't do? Are you so over the patriarchy and middle-aged white dudes mansplaining how things work in the real world? Ever wish that people who talk so much about the real world actually lived in it so people like you and me could succeed? I'm talking money, girl. Like the money you need to pay your bills and your rent and to buy those cute outfits that you deserve to be wearing. Real money. Not my parents are rich so I can take an internship and still make it money, but I'm gonna earn my way to the top because I got hustle for days and what I lack in connections I make up for with ambition kind of money. Money you earned and deserve, fair and square. We all gotta eat, girl, but we don't have to eat shit, if you know what I mean. So if you're more interested in getting shit done than taking it, and if you want to join a diverse community of like-minded badass babes who know that the world is better when we let everyone have a seat at the table, then this is the job for you. But we don't like to call this a job. It's more of a calling, an answer to the warrior woman who lives inside of you. The one who is willing to break barriers and shatter glass ceilings. We're manifesting a new visionary support strategist to be the right hand to our superstar founder. As the newest team member, you'll be learning from the best and crushing the rest. From daily tasks to innovative asks, our fast-paced environment will give you countless opportunities to shine. So, if this sounds like something you'd be interested in, what are you waiting for, girl? Join us at the greenhouse. You're not serious, Harper said, looking up from the screen at her roommate Poppy, who was refilling their glasses of rosé and smiling. I'm totally serious, and you have to admit it's kind of dead on about all the things you've been bitching about. I haven't been bitching, Harper said, stung. Because yes, she had been bitching. If Harper were honest, it was the only thing she had been successful at for the last 3 months. She accepted her refill and sat back on her end of the couch facing Poppy, their legs outstretched toward each other. They always sat like this, with Poppy's legs, which went on for days, hanging over the armrest on either side of Harper. In the middle, on the blanket draped over their knees, they propped up the ever-present bowl of popcorn that they picked at when reading magazines, books, their iPads, or, like tonight, job listings on a laptop they passed back and forth between them. I can't say I blame you for being fed up, and by the sound of this ad, you're not alone. And while I don't love being called out for being wealthy enough to work for free, it is true, so. You work hard, Poppy. I've never seen anyone work as hard as you do. Besides, I'm grateful to your parents for letting me live here for so little. I wouldn't be able to live in Manhattan on a freelancer's salary if it weren't for them. It still nearly killed Harper to pay her share of the rent each month. Cobbled together from the cater-waiter job she did on the weekends and the college essay she edited and overcharged for. After a series of bad luck that had seen Harper lose her job at a literary agency after it folded and then an entry-level job at a small publishing house when it was gobbled up in a merger, she still hadn't been able to find a steady paying gig. She hadn't expected it to be so hard to find another job where she would be overworked and underpaid. New York was full of them. But at 27, when there were younger competitors who were willing to work more and get paid less, Harper's road seemed to be leading nowhere. My parents are fine with what you pay. Besides, they've had this place forever. They got it when my dad was doing his residency, and I am sure they paid nothing for it back in the day. It was true that the large, boxy, two-bedroom apartment in a pre-war doorman building on the Upper East Side had been acquired for a fraction of what it was worth now. But even that fraction was the kind of money that Harper had never known. Like everyone else who had only experienced New York City through movies or books, Harper Cruz had arrived in Manhattan looking to find the kind of real estate steal that characters in television shows always mentioned when justifying their giant apartments in prime neighborhoods. The ones they were supposedly house-sitting, or that had been passed down to them, or were miraculously rent-controlled. Harper had chosen to believe that she was going to be lucky too, because Manhattan Harper's life was going to be far more glamorous than Poughkeepsie Harper's life. But she soon realized the only apartment she could afford was the one in New Jersey she ended up sharing with a cat-loving school teacher named Norma. The commute into the city was brutal. If life were a movie, a handsome, wealthy man would have bumped into our young, fish-out-of-water protagonist on the subway, asking her, "Hey, what's with all the hives on your face?" She'd tell him it turned out that she was allergic to her roommate's cats. But she couldn't leave now because she'd given her first and last month's rent, which was really all the money she had left. She'd assure him that the two-hour commute wasn't all that bad because it gave her time to read in the mornings. She could just take an antihistamine every day, even though that made her drowsy. And he'd look at her like he was charmed by her weird logic, swollen face and puffy eyes, and say something like, "You know, my roommate is moving out, and if you wanted, you could take his room. You'd only have to pay the maintenance fee on the apartment because my rich parents aren't looking to make money on the place. They just want me to have someone who is stable and nice and normal to live with. No strings attached. No funny stuff. So what do you say, Hives?" And of course, our heroine would say yes, and we would all feel butterflies in our stomachs because clearly sparks are going to fly between these two, and we cannot wait to see it all unfold. In real life, that handsome young stranger had been Poppy, Harper's gorgeous coworker at the now-defunct literary agency they met at. Standing just shy of 6'2", Poppy was the type of beauty that required no makeup and looked like a long-lost Hadid sister. The departing roommate, who was actually a model, spent all her time partying and always ended up bringing the party home, so anyone compared to her looked pretty great to Poppy's parents. And instead of a romance, a friendship flourished, because it turned out that Poppy was even nicer than she was beautiful. So it all worked out in the end. At least until Harper lost her job twice and discovered just how hard it was to get another one. Whether she liked it or not, Harper had entered the beggars-can't-be-choosers phase of her job hunt. "I don't know," Harper said, reading the ad again. "Girl, badass babe, can you imagine Gretchen calling us that?" I can't imagine Gretchen remembering our names, which is why she called us lady all the time, Poppy said, adding chili lime salt to her palmful of popcorn. Come to think of it, I don't think she remembered anyone's names, not even her authors, which is probably why her literary agency folded. "Hey, lady, I need you to do something for me," Harper said, imitating her former boss. I'm not sure which is worse, lady or girl. "Lady," Poppy said, rolling her eyes. "You're just saying that to make me feel better. I told you, you don't have to feel bad about your promotion. You deserve it. You're a great editor." Harper meant it, although she would be lying if she didn't admit that part of her found it hard to watch Poppy's obstacle-free ascent to associate editor at a major publishing house. Having financial security meant that Poppy didn't have to take on extra work after hours to make ends meet. She was free to attend as many literary events and network with her well-connected parents, even more well-connected friends, as much as she wanted, without ever worrying about her credit card being rejected at lunches or cocktails. "If there is anyone I want to see killing it out there, it is you, and not some other rich girl who can afford to work 14-hour days for $50,000 a year," Poppy said, knocking Harper's shoulder with her foot. "Exactly. Those other girls suck." Harper said it to make her roommate laugh, and it worked. Even though Poppy was privileged, she did her best to make the most of it by volunteering what little time she had at the nearest library, where she ran adult literacy programs and handled preschool story time the third Tuesday of every month. She was passionate about the work she did, but nothing was going to change the fact that Poppy didn't actually have to work for a living. And if things went the way Poppy's parents expected them to, starting with her marrying her doctor boyfriend Charles and moving back to Connecticut to raise a family, she might actually stop working one day. But unlike Poppy, Harper needed to make money, like the money you need to pay your bills and your rent and to buy those cute outfits that you deserve to be wearing. Harper took another look at the ad, which was obnoxious, but catchy. She had to admit, it did feel like it was speaking directly to her. I don't even know what this job is for, she said, scanning the listing for more details. It's not for a small press in Poughkeepsie, Poppy said, tilting her head and looking Harper in the eye. A job as an editor at the Poughkeepsie Press, the town's tiny literary magazine, had just opened, and Harper's parents weren't exactly subtle about wanting her to apply for it. She knew they were only trying to help, especially since they were no longer going to be able to support her financially anymore. But the thought of moving back home still made her want to die a little. It was bad enough she had to ask for help after she lost both jobs, hoping she'd be able to find something else quickly. But now that she knew her parents' business was struggling, that was no longer an option. And if she wanted to avoid moving back home, she would have to change her situation fast.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.